Good morning everyone. This is assignment 2 and I am Tanishtha Gupta from Chemical Engineering Department. My roll number is 19112101. I am from second year fourth semester and this is my assignment 2. So let us start with the assignment. First of all, the assignment is based on the topic forced convection and free convection, and it will cover several topics which are used in explaining these two type of convections. First of all, let us start with the forced convection. Forced convection is a special type of heat transfer in which fluids are forced to move in order to increase the heat transfer. This forcing can be done with a ceiling fan, a pump, suction device or other. Examples of forced convection are cooling of internal combustion engines, air conditioning installations and nuclear reactors, condenser tubes and other heat exchange equipments. The use of ceiling fans in a home also represents a different type of forced convection. For example, ceiling fans are used both in summers and winter, as you can see in these images, but their settings are different in order to perform the certain desired task. In summer months, which is the setting of the summer month, the fan is generally set to the higher speed. The angle of the blade forces air down through the room. Generally, this corresponds to a counterclockwise rotation when looking at the fan from the below. This downward breeze aids in the evaporation of precipitation from inhabitants of the home, hence cooling them. Whereas in winter months, the fan must be used on a slower speed. The blades also spin in a different direction, generally clockwise when looking from below the fan, which pulls the cooler air up from the lower parts of the room. The cooler air from below then mixes with the warmer air that has risen and mixes the two, distributing warmer air throughout the building. Now let us consider the flow of a fluid over an immersed flat horizontal plate of very large width. The figure shows that the flow is fully developed with no entrance losses. The bulk flow or free stream velocity is represented by V. Velocity of the fluid at the surface of the flat plate is zero at the no slip condition. The region above the flat plate surface within which this change of velocity from zero to the free stream value occurs is called the boundary layer. The thickness of this region is called the boundary layer thickness and is generally denoted by delta. Boundary layer region is the region where the viscous effects and the velocity changes are significant, and an inviscid region is the region in which the frictional effects are negligible and the velocity remains essentially constant. The velocity of the fluid in the y direction from the plate increases from zero to free stream velocity. It can be seen that the boundary layer thickness increased with the distance x from the body h. The boundary layer thickness delta usually is defined as the distance from the surface to the point where the velocity is within 1% of the free shear velocity. It should be noted that the y-axis is exaggerated greatly to have a clear picture. The flow in boundary layer starts as smooth and streamlined, which is called laminar flow. At some distance from the leading edge, the flow turns chaotic, which is called turbulent, and is characterized by velocity fluctuations and highly disordered motion. The transition from laminar to turbulent flow occurs over some region, which is called the transition region. The velocity profile in the laminar region is approximately parabolic and becomes flatter in the turbulent flow. The turbulent region can be considered of three regions: laminar sublayer, where viscous effects are dominant, buffer layer, where both laminar and turbulent effects exist, and turbulent layer. The intense mixing of the fluid in the turbulent flow enhances heat and momentum transfer between fluid particles, which in turn increases the friction force and the convection heat transfer coefficient. If the solid surface is maintained at a temperature TS, which is different from the fluid temperature TF, measured at a point far away from the surface, a variation of the temperature of the fluid is observed, which is similar to the velocity variation described. That is, the fluid temperature varies from TS at the wall to the TF far away from the wall, with most of the variation occurring close to the surface. These are two diagrams in which in the diagrams you can easily see the boundary layer flow past when on a flat surface, first of all when the flow is turbulent and second of all when the flow is laminar. Also, this is the thermal boundary layer flow past a flat surface. You can easily see that the fluid temperature easily varies from TS at the wall to the TF far away from the wall, with most of the variation occurring close to the surface. If TS is greater than TF, the fluid temperature approaches asymptomatically and the temperature profile at a distance X is shown. However, a thermal boundary layer may be defined, which is similarly defined as velocity boundary layer, as the distance from the surface to the point where the temperature is within 1% of the free stream fluid temperature TF. Outside the thermal boundary layer, the fluid is assumed to be a heat sink at a uniform temperature of TF. The thermal boundary layer and the velocity boundary layer are related by the Prandtl number, is called the which is defined as the ratio of momentum and thermal diffusivity is always less than unity. The momentum boundary layer remains within the thermal boundary layer. The thermal boundary layer is generally not coincident with the velocity boundary layer, although it is certainly dependent on it. That is, the velocity boundary layer thickness and the variation of velocity, whether the flow is laminar or turbulent, etc., are all the factors which determine the temperature variation in the thermal boundary layer. If PR number, that is Prandtl number, is of the boundary is greater than 1, the boundary layers will be reversed. The thermal boundary layer and the velocity boundary layer coincides at PR equals to 1. In the diagram shown here, the relation of two boundary layers at different Prandtl number is shown. If PR number is less than 1, thermal boundary layer is above the velocity boundary layer. The graph of thermal boundary layer is above the velocity boundary layer. Similarly, if Prandtl number is greater than 1, the slope of velocity boundary layer is greater than thermal boundary layer. Also, if Prandtl number will be equal to 1, the graph slope of velocity boundary layer and thermal boundary layer will coincide. Now let us learn about the typical applications of forced convection. The first application is using a fan on a hot summer day. Suppose the sweat that our body produces is for effective heat transfer. So when the fan is off, the air around us absorbs the water vapor until it is saturated. After that, it stops and we start feeling more hot. So when we switch on the fan, the air around us starts moving. So the air never gets fully saturated, completely saturated, and hence the sweat keeps evaporating by absorbing our body heat and we feel cooler. Similarly, the second example is the radiators used in fridges, ACs and automobiles. Radiators are specifically designed for heat exchanging purposes. Radiators in fridges and ACs have an additional fan, whereas radiators in automobiles usually don't have fans. The fans provide the fresh cold air to absorb the heat from the radiator tubes and the fins during heat transfer. Whereas in automobiles, when it is in motion, the radiators naturally receive fresh air for heat transfer. Third is the instant water heating geysers or any other geysers. In geysers, the water isn't flowed due to motor, so it acts as a forced convection for heat exchange pipes. Computer case cooling or fan or water-cooled central processing unit design is also a very good example of typical applications of forced convection. Now let us learn about the thermal boundary layer. The thermal boundary layer can be defined as that region where temperature gradients are present in the flow. These temperature gradients would result from a heat exchange process between the fluid and the wall. This boundary develops until meeting the criteria at which The ratio of T minus TW upon T infinity minus TW is equal to 0.99. The temperature of the wall is TW, the temperature of the fluid outside the thermal boundary layer is T infinity, and the thickness of the thermal boundary layer is designated as delta T. At the wall, the velocity is zero and the heat transfer into the fluid takes place by conduction. Thus, the local heat flux per unit area can be calculated as Qn equals to Q upon A equals to Qn equals to minus K into partial differentiation of T with respect to Y at the wall. From Newton's law of cooling, we know that Qn equals to H into TW minus T infinity. Hence, when we combine these two equations, we have the perfect equation H equals to minus K into partial differentiation of T with respect to Y at the wall upon TW minus T infinity. The conditions that are very much required to be satisfied so that the temperature distribution satisfied is T equals to TW at Y equals to 0. Partial differentiation of T with respect to Y should be 0 at Y equals to delta T. T should be equals to T infinity at Y equals to delta T. And double partial differentiation of T with respect to Y should be equal to 0 at Y equals to 0. For low Prandtl number fluids, that is liquid metals, heat diffuses much faster than the momentum flow. Remember, PR equals to nu upon alpha, which is very less than 1, and the velocity boundary layer is fully contained within the thermal boundary layer. On the other hand, for high Prandtl number fluids, that is oils, heat diffuses much slower than the momentum, and the thermal boundary layer is contained within the velocity boundary layer. Now let us learn about the heat transfer correlation for forced convection. Since the heat transfer coefficient is a direct function of the temperature gradient next to the wall, the physical variables on which it depends can be expressed as follows. Hence, H is a function of fluid properties, velocity field, geometry, temperature, etc. As the function is dependent on several parameters, the heat transfer coefficient is usually expressed in terms of correlations involving pertinent non-dimensional numbers. Now let us learn what are Nusselt number, Prandtl number and Reynolds number. Nusselt number Nu is defined as the ratio of Hx upon K, that is convection heat transfer strength upon conduction heat transfer strength. Prandtl number Pr is defined as epsilon naught upon alpha, that is momentum diffusivity upon thermal diffusivity. Reynolds number, that is Re, is defined as the ratio of rho into u mu into L upon mu equals to inertia force upon viscous force. The viscous force provides a dampening effect for disturbances in the fluid. If dampening is strong enough, it leads to laminar flow. Otherwise, if there is instability, there will be a turbulent flow, which leads to a critical Reynolds number. For forced convection, the heat transfer correlation can be expressed as Nu, which is a function of Reynolds number and Prandtl number. The convective correlation for laminar flow across a flat plate heated to a constant wall temperature is, you can see the diagram in which we have shown how the laminar flow across a flat plate happens when it is heated, and NuX, which is the Nusselt number at X, can be calculated as 0.323 into the under root of REX into Prandtl number raised to the power 1 by 3, where NuX is defined as Hx upon K, Reynolds number is defined as U into X into rho upon mu, and Prandtl number is defined as Cp into mu upon K. Now let us learn about the physical meaning of Prandtl number. The Prandtl number was introduced in the previous slide. If we multiply and divide the equation by the fluid density rho, we obtain epsilon naught upon alpha. The Prandtl number may be seen to be a ratio reflecting the ratio of the rate that viscous force penetrates the material to the rate that the thermal energy penetrates the material. As a consequence, the Prandtl number is proportional to the rate of growth of the two boundary layers, that is delta upon delta T equals to under root 1 by 3, under root nahi, sorry, 1 by 3 to the power Prandtl number. physical meaning of Nusselt number. A Nusselt number may be physically described as well. Nux, that is Nusselt number at x equals to hx upon k. If we recall that the thickness of the boundary layer at any point along the surface delta is also a function of x, then Nux can be proportional to h delta upon k, which is proportional to delta upon k into a upon 1 upon h into a. We see that the Nusselt number may be viewed as the ratio of the conduction resistance of a material to the convection resistance of the same material. Recalling the Biot number and comparing, Nux equals to Hx upon K fluid, whereas Biot number is Hx upon K solid. The denominator of the Nusselt number involves the thermal conductivity of the fluid at the solid-fluid convective interface. The denominator of the Biot number involves the thermal conductivity of the solid at the solid-fluid convective interface. Hence, the K of the Biot number at NUX of the Biot number and Nusselt number is not interchangeable. They are both different and both define different things at the solid-fluid interface. Now let us learn about laminar and turbulent flow. The formation of the boundary layer starts at the leading edge. In the starting region, the flow is well ordered. The streamlines along which particles move is regular. The velocity at any point remains steady. This type of flow is defined as laminar flow. Defined as fluid gliding through a surface channel in smooth layers, where the innermost layer flows at a higher rate than the outermost. Laminar flow develops an insulating blanket around the channel wall and restricts heat transfer. Many equipment manufacturers publish specific flow and supply pressure requirements to achieve turbulent flow. Advantage temperature control units, portable and central liquid chillers, and pump tank stations are designed to generate the turbulent flow. There is no macroscopic mixing between the layers. The momentum or heat transfer is mainly at the molecule diffusion level in the laminar flow. However, after some distance in the flow, macroscopic mixing is found to be occurred. Due to the mixing, the boundary layer thickness is larger. The energy flow rate is also higher. The velocity and temperature profiles are flatter, but the gradient at the surface is steeper due to the same reason. Large particles of fluid is found to move from one layer to another. The motion of the particles become irregular. The velocity at any location varies with respect to a mean value. The flow is said to be turbulent flow. Characterized by turbulence, where fluid does not flow in smooth layers but is agitated. Heat transfer occurs at the channel wall. Turbulent flow, due to the agitation factor, develops no insulating blanket and heat is transferred very rapidly. Turbulent flow occurs when the velocity in a given channel is high, although too much velocity can also cause erosion. Turbulent flow also will extend the useful life of the process tooling by slowing the buildup of precipitates on the heat transfer surface. Now let us learn some equations related to laminar flow. Reynolds number in the laminar flow is defined as d mu um upon mu, which is equals to 4g upon pi t mu. Friction factor F is defined as below. In this equation, we can easily see the equation penetrating to the friction factor F, where delta P is a pressure drop in the length L. The other terms defined as usual. This factor F, which is also called as Darcy friction factor, is also equal to 4CF, where CF is known as fanning friction coefficient, defined as 2 into tau W upon rho into U square. The local friction coefficient and the Nusselt number at the location X for laminar flow over a flat plate are Nux is Hx upon K, which is 0.332 into under root of Rex into Prandtl number raised to the power of 1 by 3. We must know that Prandtl number should be greater than 0.6. And CFX, which is fanning friction coefficient, is defined as 0.664 upon Rex under root, where X is the distance from the leading edge of the plate and Rex is defined as rho into V infinity into X upon mu. Hydrodynamic boundary layer thickness, which is delta X, is 5x upon r ex under root. The thermal boundary layer thickness, which is delta Tx, is defined as delta x into Prandtl number raised to the power minus 0.33. Displacement thickness, which is delta D, is defined as delta x upon 3. And momentum thickness, which is delta M, is defined as delta x upon 7. The average friction coefficient and the Nusselt number over the entire isothermal plate for a laminar region is defined as Nu equals to HL upon K, which is equal to 0.664 into under root Reynolds number L into Prandtl number raised to the power 1 by 3. Again, Prandtl number should be greater than 0.6, and fanning friction coefficient, this is CF, is equal to 1.328 upon under root REL. Taking the critical Reynolds number to be 5 into 10 to the power 5, the length of the plate XCR over which the flow is laminar can be determined from a Reynolds number CR equals to 5 into 10 to the power 5 equals to V infinity into XCR upon epsilon I naught. For low values of Prandtl number, as in the case of liquid metals, the local Nusselt number is NUX equals to 0.565 into under root of REX into Prandtl number. This is valid for Prandtl number less than 0.05, which can be found in liquid metals. A general expression for both high and low values of Prandtl number is given below, which is NUX equals to 0.3387 into under root REX into Prandtl number to be raised to the power 0.33 upon 1 plus 0.0468 upon Prandtl number raised to the power 0.67 whole raised to the power 0.25. In constant heat flux boundary, the plane temperature varies along the lengths. Hence, the temperature difference between the plate and the free stream varies continuously. The average difference in the temperature between the fluid and the surface length x is given by this equation. Twx minus T infinity equals to Qx upon K upon 0.6795 Reynolds number raised to the power 0.5 into Prandtl number raised to the power 0.33. For low as well as high values of Prandtl number, the relationship is for Prandtl number that is less than 0.05 but is greater than 50. We have this equation. In all the other cases, the average Nusselt number is given by NUL equals to 2 NUL. This is applicable for in all the cases where NU is proportional to under root of Reynolds number. Property values should be at the film temperature, that is TS plus T infinity by 2. Hausen presents the following empirical relation for the fully developed laminar flow in tubes at constant wall temperature. NU equals to 3.66 plus 0.0668 into T by L into Reynolds number Prandtl number upon 1 plus 0.04 into D by L into Reynolds number into Prandtl number whole raised to the power 0.06. Now let us learn about typical applications of laminar flow. First of all, we have all went to the grocery shops. The big showcases for cooling of the things displayed there is a very good example of laminar flow. In open display cases, it's important to keep the product cool, but blowing excess chilled air wastes energy. So the refrigerated air tends to be laminar by design. Second example is drainage. Creating turbulent flow requires more energy, and since drainage is not typically a value-added operation, using minimal flow to get a job done results in laminar flow. Flow over an aircraft wing. The boundary layer is a very thin sheet of air lying over the surface of the wing and all other surfaces of the aircraft. Because air has viscosity, this layer of air tends to adhere to the wing. As the wing moves forward through the air, the boundary layer at first flows smoothly over the streamlined shape of the airfoil. Hence, the flow is laminar and the boundary layer is a laminar layer. Prandtl applied the concept of laminar boundary layer to airfoils in the year 1904. The Mustang was a mathematically designed airplane, and the wing foil that was to be classified as a semi-empirical venture by the British was cleared for adoption on the new design. Laminar flow is most often found at the front of a streamlined body and is an important factor in flight. If the smooth flow of air is interrupted over a wing section, turbulence is created, which results in a loss of lift and a high degree of drag. An airfoil designed for minimum drag and uninterrupted flow of the boundary layer is called as laminar airfoil. The laminar flow theory dealt with the development of a symmetrical airfoil section which had the same curvature on both the upper and lower surfaces. The design was relatively thin at the leading edge and progressively widened to a point of greatest thickness as far as possible. The theory in using an airfoil of this design was to maintain the adhesion of the boundary layers of airflow which are present in flight as far aft of the leading edge as possible. On normal airfoils, the boundary layer would be interrupted at high speeds and the resultant break would cause a turbulent flow over the remainder of the foil. The turbulence would be realized as drag up the point of maximum speed, at which time the control surfaces and aircraft flying characteristics would be effective. The formation of the boundary layer is a process of layers of air found one next to the other, that is, the term laminar is derived from the lamination principle involved. The North American P-51 Mustang, as described above, was the first aircraft intentionally designed to use laminar flow airfoils. The boundary layer concept is credited to the great German aerodynamist Ludwig Prandtl. Prandtl hypothesized and proved the existence of boundary layer long before the Mustang was a gleam in anyone's eye. Now let us learn about some equations relating to turbulent flow. In the turbulent flow, the Reynolds number should be greater than 5 into 10 to the power 5 and specified. In the turbulent region, the velocity boundary layer thickness is given by the following equation, that is delta x equals to 0.381 x into Reynolds number raised to the power minus 0.2, and delta t is similar to delta x. The displacement and the momentum thickness are much thinner. The displacement thickness is delta d equals to delta x upon 8. The momentum thickness is delta m equals to 7 upon 72 into delta x. The local friction coefficient is defined as tau w upon rho u infinity whole square upon 2 is given for the range Reynolds number from 5 into 10 to the power 5 to 5 into 10 to the power 7 by CFX equals to 0.0592 into Reynolds number at x raised to the power minus 0.2. For higher values of Reynolds number in the range 10 to the power 7 to 10 to the power 9, CFX, that is local friction coefficient, is given by 0.37 into log 10 of Reynolds number raised to the power minus 0.584. The local Nusselt number is given by 0.0296 into REX raised to the power 0.8 into Prandtl number raised to the power 0.33. The average Nusselt number is given by 0.037 into Reynolds number raised to the power 0.8 and Prandtl number raised to the power 0.33. Nu equals to Nux upon 0.8 in this case, as Nu is dependent on REX raised to the power 0.8. Using analogy between momentum and heat transfer, Nux, that is local Nusselt number, is given by this equation, which is dependent upon local friction coefficient, Reynolds number, Prandtl number. For constant heat flux, the Nusselt number is found to increase by 4% over the value for the constant wall temperature, that is NUX constant heat flux equals to 1.04 NUX constant wall temperature. Nusselt number at the location X for turbulent flow over a flat isothermal plate is given by this equation, HX upon K, which is defined by 0.0296 into Reynolds number raised to the power 4 by 5 into Prandtl number raised to the power 1 by 3. The constraints for Prandtl number and Reynolds numbers are here. The average friction coefficient and the Nusselt number over the isothermal plate in turbulent flow are given by these two equations. We should always remember the constraints under which the Reynolds number and Prandtl number work in every equation. Now let us learn about typical applications of turbulent flow. Turbulent flow is desirable in applications where relatively cool fluid is mixed with a warmer fluid to reduce the temperature of the warmer fluid. Common examples of turbulent flow are blood flow in arteries, oil transport in pipelines, lava flow, atmosphere and ocean currents, the flow through pumps and turbines, and the flow in boat wakes and around aircraft wingtips. Turbulent flow is preferred over laminar flow in application where good mixing is required, such as in combustion mixing tanks, chemical reactors. This is because of the inherent unsteady nature of turbulent flow, whereas random fluctuation on the flow properties occur, particularly the velocity. Dimples present in a golf ball. Boundary layer separation is a common phenomena, and in laminar flow, the separation occurs faster. The drag to the ball is considerably higher in laminar flow and hence travels smaller distance. To make the flow turbulent, making the separation slower and hence reduce the drag, dimples have been introduced. Now let us, you can in the corresponding figure easily see how the smooth ball and difference between the golf ball. Air flows smoothly around the ball, which quickly separate as it flies by, and a large vortex of swirling air creates heavy drag. Whereas in the golf ball, dimples create turbulences, which sucks air to the ball. This delays separation. A smaller vortex is created, with less drag. Now let us learn about dimensionless groups. A dimensionless group is a combination of dimensional or dimensionless quantities having zero overall dimensions. In a system of coherent units, it can therefore be represented by a pure number. The value of dimensionless groups for generalizing experimental data has been long recognized. Over 100 years ago, G.G. Stokes demonstrated the importance of the group now known as Reynolds number as a criterion for similarity of fluid behavior under different conditions. It was Helmholtz who showed the significance of the groups now known as Froude number and Mach number. Initially, the dimensionless groups did not have specific names, and the first to attach names was M. J. Weber in 1919 when he allocated the titles Froude, Reynolds and Cauchy to the groups. The dimensionless group is a product of the quantities, each raised to a power such that the product has no dimensions. In our example, where the quantities are A, V and R, any dimensionless group G has the form G equals to A raised to the power X, N raised to the power Y, R raised to the power Z. Where G has no dimensions and where the exponents X, Y and Z are real numbers, they can be negative or zero. Because any equation describing the world can be written in dimensionless form, and because any dimensionless form can be written using dimensionless groups, any equation describing the world can be written using dimensionless groups. Dimensional analysis. The study of the relationship between physical quantities with the help of dimensions and units of measurement is termed as dimensional analysis. Dimensional analysis is essential because it keeps the units same, helping us perform mathematical calculations smoothly. When more than three parameters influence a problem, it becomes very difficult to analyze the effect of each on the problem. It is therefore found desirable to group these parameters into dimensionless parameters so that the number of variables can be reduced to three. In this attempt to formulate dimensionless groups, the Pi theorem proposed by Buckingham is useful. Now here is a list of some of the dimensionless numbers, their physical significance and their expression. The most important dimensionless number which is used in heat transfer or in free and forced convection are Nusselt, Reynolds, Prandtl, Stanton, Picklet and Gratz. These all are dimensionless numbers and their physical significance is also given in this list. From this list, we can see that Nusselt is described as a ratio of wall temperature gradient upon temperature gradient across the fluid in the pipe. Similarly, Reynolds is described as a ratio of inertial force upon viscous force. Prandtl is described as a ratio of momentum diffusivity to thermal diffusivity. Stanton is described as the ratio of heat flux by convection upon heat flux by bulk flow. Becquerel is defined as the ratio of heat flux by bulk flow to the heat flux by conduction. And Gratz is defined similarly as Becquerel number, however used in connection with analysis of heat transfer in laminar flow in pipes of length L at a distance d. Their formulas are also given in the right hand side. You can easily see these formulas and say and verify that these any of these formula does not has any dimension. Buckingham pi theorem. If there are n variables in a problem and these variables contain m primary dimensions, for example m, l, t, the equation relating all the variables will have n minus m dimensionless groups. Buckingham referred to these groups as pi groups. The final equation obtained is in the form of pi 1 equals to pi 1 is a function of pi 2, pi 3 till pi n minus m. The pi groups must be independent of each other and no one group should be formed by multiplying together powers of other groups. In this method of solving the equation, there are two conditions which must be satisfied. Each of the fundamental dimension must appear in at least one of the m variables. It must not be possible to form a dimensionless group from one of the variables within a recurring set. A recurring set is a group of variables forming a dimensionless group. Significance of Buckingham pi theorem. The Buckingham pi theorem provides a method for computing sets of dimensionless parameters from given variables, even if the form of the equation remains unknown. However, the choice of dimensionless parameters is not unique. Buckingham theorem only provides a way of generating sets of dimensionless parameters and does not indicate the most physically meaningful. Two systems for which these parameters coincide are called similar. As with similar triangles, they differ only in scale. They are equivalent for the purposes of the equation, and the experimentalist who wants to determine the form of the equation can choose the most convenient one according to his or her own convenience. Most importantly, Buckingham's theorem describes the relation between the number of variables and the fundamental dimensions. Now, in engineering the applied mathematics and physics, the Buckingham pi theorem is a key theorem in dimensional analysis. It is a formalization of Regel's method of dimensional analysis. Loosely, the theorem states that if there is a physically meaningful equation involving a certain number n of physical variables, then the original equation can be rewritten in the terms of a set of number p equals to n minus k dimensional parameters pi 1, pi 2, till pi p constructed from the original variables. Here k is the number of physical dimensions involved. It is obtained as the rank of the particular matrix. The theorem provides a method for computing sets of dimensionless parameters from the given variables or non-dimensionalization even if the form of equation is still known. Buckingham pi theorem indicates that validity of laws of physics does not depend on specific unit system. A statement of this theorem is that any physical law can be expressed as an identity involving only dimensionless combinations, which is ratios or products, of the variables linked by the law, that is, pressure and volume are linked by the Boyle's law, they are inversely proportional. If the dimensionless combination values change within the system of units, then the equation would not be an identity and Buckingham theorems would not hold. Now let us learn about internal flow. In case of internal flow, the fluid is confined by a surface and the boundary layer after some distance cannot develop further. This region is called entrance region. The region beyond this point is known as fully developed region. Also, the flow does not change over at a location from laminar to turbulent condition but is laminar or turbulent from the start, depending upon the value of Reynolds number, which is based on diameter being greater or less than 2300. In many cases, there is no well-defined free stream velocity as in the case of flow over a flat plate. So mean velocity using the mass flow is to be adopted in place of u infinity. The mean velocity um is defined by the following equation, which is calculated by 1 upon a into integral of u with respect to area. The flow rate is defined by rho into a into um, which is rho pi d square upon 4 into um. In the case of circular section, a is pi d square upon 4, which is used in the above equation while defining the flow rate. Now let us learn about typical applications of internal flow flows through pipes, ducts, nozzles, diffusers, valves, and fittings are all examples of internal flow. Now let us learn about external flow. In fluid mechanics, external flow is such a flow that boundary layers develop freely without constraints imposed by adjacent surfaces. Accordingly, there will always exist a region of the flow outside the boundary layer in which velocity, temperature, or concentration gradients are negligible. It can be defined as the flow of fluid around a body that is completely submerged in it. Typical applications of external flow. Any example includes fluid motion over a flat plate and flow over curved surfaces such as sphere, cylinder, airfoil or turbine plate, air flowing around airplane and water flowing around the submarines. Flow around a glass is car while washing it is also defined as external flow. Now let us learn about understand the flow over a flat plate. Under the force convection, fluid velocity at the surface of the plate is zero because of no slip condition and gradually increases with distance from the plate. At a sufficiently large distance from the plate, the fluid velocity becomes equal to the free stream velocity v. The region above the plate surface within which this change of velocity from zero to the free stream value occurs is called the boundary layer, or more specifically the velocity boundary layer, which is also known as momentum boundary layer or the hydrodynamic boundary layer. The thickness of this region is called the boundary layer thickness and is denoted by delta. The boundary layer thickness increases with the distance r from the leading edge of the plate, that is delta is equal to delta x, is a function of x. Now in this diagram we can easily see how the buffer zone, laminar zone, transition region, laminar low and turbulent region is defined over the boundary layers. The characteristic of a flow past a flat plate with finite length L subject to different Reynolds number at a low Reynolds number, that is RE, can be equal to 0.1. The presence of the flat plate is felt in a relatively large area where the viscous effects are important. At moderate Reynolds number, that can be RE equals to 10, the viscous layer region becomes smaller. Viscous effects are only important inside of this region and streamlines are defected as fluid enters it. As the Reynolds number is increased, that is RE equals to 10 to the power 7, only a thin boundary layer develops near the flat plate and the fluid forms a narrow wake region behind the flat plate. Hence, the flow can be considered as inviscid flow everywhere except the boundary layer region. Now consider flow past an infinite long flat plate with negligible thickness. In this case, the Reynolds number is defined using the local distance x, that is distance from the leading edge along the flat plate, as the characteristic length. The local Reynolds number is then given by mu rho into u into x upon mu. As the fluid flows past the long flat plate, the flow will become turbulent at a critical distance xcr downstream from the leading edge. For flow past a flat plate, transition from laminar to turbulent begins when the critical Reynolds temperature RE at xcr reaches 5 into 10 to the power 5. The boundary layer changes from laminar to turbulent at this point. Heat transfer in a flow over a flat plate occurs through the boundary layer formed on the plane. Therefore, at any location, the heat transfer coefficient will depend upon the local Reynolds and Prandtl number. For local heat transfer coefficient in laminar boundary layer flow, the following correlation can be used to find the local Nusselt number. It depends upon the distance from the leading edge x of the plate. The local Nusselt number is given by 0.332 into under root of REX into Prandtl number raised to the power 1 by 3. Prandtl number lies from 0.5 to 50. The constraint, the NUX is defined as XH upon K, and Reynolds number is defined as XVP rho upon mu, and are the local Nusselt and Reynolds number respectively. An average value of the heat transfer coefficient over distance L is obtained by integral of HXH into DX from 0 to L upon L. An average Nusselt number is defined as 0.6664 into under root of R Reynolds number into Prandtl number raised to the power 1 by 3. A triple correlation exists for the heat transfer in turbulent boundary layer flow, where local Nusselt number is calculated by 0.029 into Reynolds number raised to the power 4 by 5 into Prandtl number raised to the power 1 by 3. Reynolds number lies from 5 into 10 to the power 5 to 10 to the power 7 range, and Prandtl number lies from 0.6 to 60. They both lie on the higher end of the spectrum basically. Now let us learn about the forced convection flow around a cylinder. In this diagram we can see how the forced different types of flow occurs across a cylinder. When Reynolds number is less than 5, the region is unseparated flow. When Reynolds number is from 5 to 15 to 40, a fixed pair of vortices in wake. When Reynolds number is from 40 to 90 or 90 to 150, two regions in which vortex sheet is a laminar. When Reynolds number is from 150 to 300 or 300 into 3 to power 10 to 5, the either transition range to turbulent hota hai ya fir vortex sheet is fully turbulent. When Reynolds number lies from 10 to the power 5 into 3 to the power 0.5 into 10 to the power 6, laminar boundary layer has undergone turbulent transition and wake is narrower and disorganized. When Reynolds number is greater than 3.5 into 10 to the power 6, re-establishment of turbulent vortex sheet. Ford, according to Ford correlation, the Nusselt number can be calculated by this equation. Given that Reynolds number lies under this constraint, another equation is given by Eckert and Drake, where Nusselt number can be calculated by this equation or this equation, but the range constraint range for both the equations is different. For using the above equation, the Reynolds number must lie between this constraint, that is 10, greater than 10 to the power 3 and less than 2 into 10 to the power 5. And for using this equation, the Reynolds number must lie from 1 to the 10 to the power 3. Churchill and Bernstein also gave a correlation for calculating the Nusselt number. This equation can be used for calculating the Nusselt number. But we must remember the constraint. However, the following equation, which is given downstairs, is more accurate for condition where Reynolds number lies between 20,000 to 40,000, and R product of RE and PR is greater than 0.2. Whitaker has also given a correlation for calculating the Nusselt number, which is given by this equation. However, the constraints are there, which is RE must lie from 40 to 10 to the power 5, and Prandtl number must lie from 0.65 to 300, and the ratio of mu upon mu w must be from 0.25 to 5.2. Now let us learn about the flow around a sphere. The flow around a sphere is of some doubt of this type. There is separated flow around upper and lower surface, and there is a relative drag force on the surface. Cramer's correlation of liquids past a sphere is given by this equation. Nusselt number into Prandtl number raised to the power minus 1 by 3 equals to 0.97 plus 0.68 into under root RE. Applicability of the equation is only when Reynolds number lies from 1 to 2000. Whitaker correlation can be used from the rest of the equation. This is the Whitaker correlation. Now let us learn about free convection. What is free convection? Natural or free convection is observed as a result of the motion of the fluid due to density changes arising from the heating process. A hot radiator used for heating a room is one example of a practical device that transfers heat by free convection. The movement of the fluid in free convection, whether it is a gas or liquid, results from the buoyancy forces imposed on the fluid when its density in the proximity of the heat transfer surface is decreased as a result of the heating process. The buoyancy force would not be present if the fluid were not acted upon by some external force field such as gravity. A fluid enclosed in a rotating machine is acted upon by a centrifugal force field and thus could experience free convection currents if one or more of the surface in contact with fluid were heated. The buoyancy force that give rise to the free convection currents are called body forces. In natural convection, the fluid velocity far from the solid body will be zero. However, near the solid body, there will be some fluid motion if the body is at temperature difference different from that of the free fluid. In this situation, there will be a density difference between the fluid near the solid surface and that far away from the system. There will be a positive or negative buoyancy force due to this density difference. Hot surfaces will create positive buoyancy force, whereas the cold surfaces will create negative buoyancy force. Therefore, buoyancy force will be driving force which produces and maintains the free convective process. The initial boundary layer, so development is laminar, but at some distance from the leading edge, depending upon the liquid properties and the temperature difference between wall and the environment, turbulent eddies are formed, and transition to turbulent layer begins. Farther up the plate, the boundary layer may become fully turbulent. In this diagram, we can see the free convection boundary layer across the heated plate, a hot vertical wire, and over a hot horizontal cylinder. In this diagram, free convection flow patterns can be seen over a cold vertical surface on a hot surface facing up, on a cold surface facing up, on a hot surface facing down, on a cold surface facing down, and on a vertical enclosure with a cold parallel surfaces. However, when a fluid is enclosed between two horizontal surfaces at a distance L apart, say, the lower surface being hot and the upper surface being cold, heat transfer occurs practically by pure conduction, where the Grashof number GR is less than 1700. However, when the Grashof number is greater than this, that is greater than 1700, free convection begins and a pattern of hexagonal prismatic cell is formed as shown. At the middle of each prism, the warmer fluid ascends, the colder fluid descends along the walls of the hexagonal prisms. The top surface looks like the cross-section of a honeycomb. This phenomena was first observed by Bernard in 1901 while heating a thin layer of spermaceti from below. These free convection cells are hence called Bernard cells. Other common situations of free convection heat transfer are from a horizontal plate, hot or cold, facing upwards or downwards. Now let us learn about the mechanism of natural convection. Consider a hot object exposed to a cold air. The temperature of the outside of the object will drop as a result of the heat transfer with cold air, and the temperature of adjacent air to the object will rise. Consequently, the object is surrounded with a thin layer of warmer air, and the heat will be transferred from this layer to the outer layers of the air. As we can see in the diagram, the temperature of the air adjacent to the hot object is higher, thus its density is lower. As a result, the heat air rises. The movement is called the natural convection current. Note that in the absence of this movement, heat transfer would be by conduction only, and its rate would be much lower. Now let us learn about the typical applications of free convection. System of natural circulation include tornadoes, ocean currents, and household ventilation. Some solar water heaters use natural circulation. The Gulf Stream circulates as a result of the evaporation of water. In this process, the water increases in salinity and density. In North Atlantic Ocean, for example, the water becomes so dense that it begins to sink down. In the nuclear reactor, natural circulation can be a design criterion. It is achieved by reducing turbulence and friction in the fluid flow, that is, minimizing the head loss, and by providing a way to remove any inoperative pumps from the fluid path. Also, the reactor must be physically lower than the steam generators or turbines. In this way, natural circulation will ensure that the fluid will continue to flow as long as the reactor is hotter than the heat sink, even when power cannot be supplied to the pumps. Notable examples are S5G123 and S8G456, United States naval reactors, which are designed to operate at significant fraction of full power under natural circulation, quieting those propulsion plants. The S6G reactor cannot operate at power under natural circulation, but can use it to maintain emergency cooling while shutting down. Now let us learn about heat transfer correlation for free convection. Over the years, it has been found that average free convection heat transfer coefficients can be represented in the following functional form for a variety of circumstances. The standard form for free or natural convection correlation will appear much like those in the forced convection, except that Reynolds number is replaced by Grashof number, and the exponent of Prandtl number is generally not 1 by 3. The von Karman boundary layer analysis, from which we developed the 1 by 3 exponent, was for only forced convection flows. that hence the local Nusselt number is equals to C into Grashof number X at raised to the power M into Prandtl number raised to the power N, and average Nusselt number is equal to C into Grashof number at raised to the power M into Prandtl number raised to the power N. Quite often experimentalists find that the exponent on the Grashof and Prandtl numbers are equal, so that the general coefficient may be written as Grashof number and Prandtl number both raised to the power M in both local and average correlations. This leads to the introduction of a new dimensionless parameter, the Rayleigh number. Rayleigh number is defined as product of Grashof number and Prandtl number, so that the general coefficient for the free convection becomes Nusselt number is equals to a constant into Rayleigh number both raised to the power M both in local and average correlations. Now let us define Grashof number and Rayleigh number. Grashof number, GR, is the ratio between the buoyancy force and the viscous force. That is, Grashof number equals to G into beta delta T into L raised to power Q upon V square, which can be defined as G into B, and delta T is TS minus T infinity into L raised to power 3 upon V raised to power 2. Grashof number replaces the Reynolds number in the convection correlation equation. In free convection, buoyancy driven flow sometimes dominates the flow inertia. Therefore, the Nusselt number is a function of the Grashof number and the Prandtl number alone. Nusselt number is a function of Grashof number and Prandtl number. Reynolds number will be important if there is an external flow, combined forced or free convection. In many instances, it is better to combine the Grashof number and the Prandtl number to define a new parameter, the Rayleigh number. The most important use of the Rayleigh number is to characterize the laminar to turbulence transition of a free convection boundary layer flow. For example, when Rayleigh number is greater than 10 to the power 9, the free vertical free convection boundary layer flow over a flat plate becomes turbulent. We should understand what are these dimensions for. Variables stand for? G stands for gravitational acceleration, beta stands for coefficient of volume expansion, delta stands for characteristic length of the geometry, V stands for kinematic viscosity of the fluid. The role played by Reynolds number in forced convection is often played by Grashof number in the natural convection. The critical Grashof number is observed to be about 10 to the power 9 for vertical plates. Therefore, as find out here, when Grashof number is greater than 10 to the power 9, the flow becomes turbulent. The heat transfer rate in natural convection is expressed by Newton's law of cooling. Rayleigh number is defined as a product of Grashof and Prandtl number, that is GR into PR, and it is the equation of the Rayleigh number is given here. Now let us learn about free convection over a flat surface. The rate of free convection heat transfer from a flat surface or plate generally depends upon the orientation of the plate, whether it is vertical, inclined or horizontal. Again, a horizontal plate may be hot or cold, and the hot or cold surface may face upwards or downwards. A single correlation does not cover all these situations. For a vertical plate, hot or cold, the following equation suggested by Churchill and Chu in 1975 may be used for the entire range of Rayleigh number. The equation is given here. However, if the laminar flow is laminar, that is Rayleigh number is less than 10 to the power 9, it is better to use this equation. This is a flat plate, this is the length, this is the width, and the flow can be anyways. However, similarly, if there is a free convection over a cylinder, Churchill and Chu have provided the following expression for natural convective heat transfer of a horizontal cylinder. In the cylinder, the orientation of the cylinder is very important. When the cylinder is horizontal, this equation can be used, and the Rayleigh number should lie between this constraint. According to Morgan, for horizontal cylinder, this equation can be used, and the value of the C, that is the constant, can be calculated according to the constraint of the Rayleigh number, which is given in this table, and D stands for the diameter of the cylinder in both the equation. In the case of vertical cylinder, the equations for a vertical flat plate are applicable if the thickness of the free convection boundary layer is much smaller than the cylinder. The cylinder may be considered to be equivalent of a vertical flat plate of a breadth equal to the circumference of the cylinder. The criteria for this quantitatively is given by the ratio of D and L, that is diameter and length of the cylinder, should be greater than 35 to the and ratio of ratio of number at length L is raised to the power 1 by. Hence, this is the end of the slideshow. I would like to say thank you for giving me your attention and providing me this opportunity to present my thoughts and to present this presentation before you. I would specifically like to thank my teacher, Mr. Shashikant Yadav, for giving me this opportunity to present my presentation before you over the topic free and forced convection, which are a very important part of my syllabus. This PPT gave me an very good chance to understand these topics again and to revise and to find out where I am deficient in these topics and where I lack. Hence, I would like to say thank you. And if there is any doubts and queries, please tell me. And if the information provided by me is wrong anywhere, please email me and try to correct me. Thank you. And I would like to repeat my roll number and my name. My name is Tanishtha Gupta. And my roll number is 19112101. I'm from Chemical Engineering Department, second year, fourth semester, NIT Jalandhar. Thank you.